Hi, I want to welcome everybody to today's webcast. My name is Michael Giannotti, and I'm a technical specialist with the Microsoft Healthcare and Life Sciences Group. Today's broadcast is on situational response management, communications, and virtual patient outreach. We have quite a packed schedule with a lot of speakers today. So real quickly, we'd like to go through some housekeeping items first. Just as an informational, as always, today's event is brought to you by the Microsoft Healthcare and Life Sciences Group. You can visit us at our blog at aka.ms/HLSblog. That's aka.ms/HLSblog. At the conclusion of today's webcast, we will be posting the archive video as well as all the resources we'll be covering today. So keep that in mind. It's aka.ms/HLSblog. Couple of housekeeping items before we get started. First of all, we encourage you to ask questions. I do want to remind our audience, though, today we expect it to be a pretty lively audience. But go ahead and ask. We'll answer as many as possible. It is important to remember questions are moderated, so you won't see your questions posted. You'll see it in your own My Questions, but we're not going to be publishing today's questions just because of the anticipated volume. What we will do is at the end of each segment for each speaker who's presenting a different section, we'll allow for a time for a couple of roll-up questions. And then at the conclusion of the presentations, we'll have an open Q&A where you can ask all of them. If at any time you don't see your question answered, we will be posting, in addition to the archive of today's presentation, we're going to have deep dives on how-tos for each of the sections. And so you'll be able to post questions directly to the blog post as well. So we encourage that. We also love, though, to just hear where you're from, and we want to acknowledge those folks. So that we will, I guess that would be the one exception. We'll publish those. If you want to give us a shout out, tell us, you know, maybe your first name and where you're from. Could be a state, city, a country. We just love hearing where people are joining from. And so we want to encourage that, and we'll type a little acknowledgement and text, and we'll publish those out just to acknowledge that you're here, and we want to thank you for attending. Again, at the conclusion of today's session, the webcast recording will be posted to the Microsoft Healthcare and Life Sciences blog at aka.ms/HLSblog, along with any of the resources mentioned during the webcast. I'll have a roll-up of them. We have a deck for the first big chunk of content that will be covered with resources in that, but I'll also pull those out and put them directly in the post. Now, real quickly, how to engage with us in the Q&A panel. So if you notice, if you don't see this at the upper right or on the right-hand side of your screen, if you're not seeing a dialogue, just simply click. You'll see a dialogue box with a question mark. You can click that to open it. That will allow you to see the questions, and I see questions and stuff firing off. That's great. We have 13 already, so people are seeing that, but you can go ahead, click that, and then here is the dialogue box and what that's going to look like for you. You'll see that you can put your name. That's optional. You can ask a question, and if you want to check this to make sure it's anonymous, you can go ahead and do that as well. No attribution to yourself is necessary, but we do love to hear who you are and where you're from. That's it for the Q&A. Again, one last reminder. Yes, this is being recorded. Yes, we will post the recording to the blog at aka.ms/HLSblog following the broadcast. Give us a couple of hours to go ahead and grab the recording and put together the resources, but we'll post that. There is also already some posts that you'll see up there that refer to some of the content that's being presented today, and we'll be adding additional. So that's really the place to keep following us, aka.ms/HLSblog. With that, I'm going to turn over to my colleague and my manager, actually, Patrick Miller, who is going to kick off today's presentation.
Thanks, Mike. Again, this is Patrick Miller. I'm the technology director for the Modern Workplace, and we do have an action-packed agenda. Hopefully, Mike, you can verify that you can see this action-packed agenda.
Right now, I'm seeing on to the presentation.
All right, let me see if I shared. Hopefully, I did. One more try. Let's try again. How about that?
There it goes. I see it now changing.
And all right, there we go. That's why the verification step, everyone. Just want to make sure. I had one more click that I didn't do. All right, so thanks, everyone, for joining. We do have an action-packed agenda and a couple of notes for sure up front. With the spread of COVID-19, the virus has impacted the lives of countless people around the world. And our thoughts are certainly with the families, the victims, and certainly those that are suffering today, as well as the caregivers, many of which we help serve. And we just thank everyone for doing that and for helping to help eradicate this disease. Beyond this, many more lives have definitely been disrupted by COVID-19 and the outbreak, causing travel, public gathering restrictions, and all sorts of impacts to services, which are challenging. This original webcast, we started with the idea of business continuity, and what we were planning to give you was some look into how Microsoft 365 could assist with really that business continuity and maintaining it. But during the planning portion of this, we obviously have seen this situation escalate. And as Microsoft, we really want to make sure that we help you with resources that we have, that we really help to make sure that you know about all the free things that we've made available, both from a configuration perspective, as well as licensing availability for you as our customers, to make sure that you can provide what's needed. So this webcast, as you can see, kind of has a mixture of both topics in it, both business continuity management as the general topic, but also COVID-19 specific, and it is very heavily demo laden. So as you watch through today, we will be flipping between multiple speakers, starting with the business continuity piece that I'll speak through, and the framework that the way we're looking at it from a framework perspective. We'll then move on and talk about the situational response pieces, helping you to see how you can use Teams and remote worker enablement. We'll go through crisis management and talk through those pieces, as well as how you can do communications and push out to your employees. Then we'll sort of switch topics to virtual patient outreach and talk about virtual visits and how you can run a bot like our Q&A bot. And these are all, like I said, demo based. So we'll have a few slides at places, but we wanted to focus on showing you how it will work, how the technology can be utilized by your employees, by your customers, patients, et cetera, and that sort of thing. And particularly after this, as Mike mentioned, we will have blog posts that follow up with step-by-steps at the HLS blog, aka.ms/HLS blog, so that each of you can step through and employ these things in your environment. So that's kind of it. There are a fair number of resources also that will be provided afterwards. So don't stress about a slide and a link, that sort of thing. So moving on to the next piece here, I wanted to talk about the idea of business continuity for a minute. And the way that I wanted to contextualize this was with the ISO standard 22301. Many of you have business continuity plans in place, and those plans in your world are something that you've had in place for some period of time. Rather than sort of abstractly talking about it, I wanted to refer to the ISO standard. And the reason that I do that is because it is a framework that that really will help with the requirements to plan, establish, implement, operate, monitor, review, maintain, and continually improve a documented management system to protect against, reduce the likelihood of occurrence, prepare for, respond to, and recover from disruptive incidents when they arise. And that is a mouthful, and I did read that, as you probably guessed. The reason being, as you think about business continuity planning and certainly this ISO standard, there are a lot of things within it that sort of help you as an organization to respond to various incidents, whether it be the current one that's on everyone's minds around the globe, or any sort of normal situation that you might have thought of previously for handling business continuity, a site down, a data network down, storms in a location that knock out power, any of those types of situations. But the key to almost all these pieces, and as I was looking through 22301 for pieces in the discussion here, communications is key, and particularly the idea of a crisis management team. How are we going to make sure that we communicate in the event that we have employees distributed like we see today? How do we make sure that we keep that team intact? And in your 22301 plan or whatever framework that you're using for business continuity planning, you actually see this idea of a crisis management team. And so as you contextualize some of the demonstrations in a moment, think about it in that context. How can I utilize this tool set to actually manage the team that is managing this incident as it goes on? And then further from that, how do I communicate to the rest of our staff to make sure they know what to do? They make sure they have current information to act, because as we talk about a lot, they're your employees are at the front line with your patients. And the idea here is you want to be sure that they are armed with the latest and greatest information. You want to make sure that they have the tools they need at their fingertips. Likewise, in this sort of planning context, you will often see the discussion about sites and locations. And I wanted to contextualize this piece with the idea of the picture on the right. And it's a little bit sketchy, but I'm going to walk you through it. The picture Office 365 or the Microsoft 365 cloud up at the top, very easy to understand. For many of our customers, especially before you first implemented, you found that you had a direct path that involved employees who are now sitting out in that cloud, that internet in the middle chunk there. And those employees would actually have to come back in through VPN and perhaps tunnel back into the enterprise network to make it back out. As you start to think about plans, and many of our organizations we work with have updated those plans and said, hey, I've got to realize that site might not be available. That location may not have a redundant location to it. And very much so, we see organizations looking to the cloud to be able to provide this continuity in the event that a particular location is not available. In this particular live situation where employees are working from their homes, they are at various sites around the globe, in fact, trying to connect. They can simply connect directly, as you see that one employee in that cloud, in the internet cloud, out in the middle, and they don't really even possibly need to go back to on-premise, depending upon your configuration. So I wanted to think about that. The next thing is the activities in order of recovery. This seems very much like a planning exercise, and you'll see as Mike goes through some of the tools here, really how you could actually have all this stuff available. As Sam goes through some of the things around teams and how you could organize the activities, the order of recovery, and if you do need to do something dynamically or decision-based based upon where you are at the moment or availability of a certain resource, be that a person or a network, technical resource, et cetera, that all the coordination activities that you see here would really be made easier through that piece. So as you look at your plan, again, whatever tool you're using, whether it be 22301 or a previous framework, what resources are you going to require, and are those available at your fingertips? And that's really the pieces from out of the plan itself. Then as you look at a response plan, again, the term communications comes up. How exactly are we going to communicate the response we have? And the response could be dynamic and need to, again, take in the context of where we are at this moment in terms of resource availability, et cetera. And then this whole idea of a crisis manager. Who is actually calling the shots? What is the order, pecking order, if you will, for who can make the decisions along the way? Who can speak to the press as things come up? And that's become very much real as we've all watched television lately and watching internet feeds on a regular basis over the weekend, for example. Exactly who can make that speech, if you will, and what are they saying? Is it the organization's message? The next thing that I wanted to share was around business continuity specific to Microsoft 365. We have already, probably in the past 2 weeks, fielded a fair number of questions from organizations saying, well, how's Microsoft doing this? How are you keeping your cloud up if I'm relying upon you? And I want to refer back to a post that we actually put into everyone's tenant and shared with you. This is a little excerpt from it, but the three areas that we say to focus on during any situation that challenges normal operations. And I would encourage you to think about this in turn in the context of your organization and your key systems as well. What is the impact to systems? Does the event have a potential impact on our systems and how we can support Microsoft 365 in our context? But you can insert inside there what your organization is worried about in your systems, your people, your processes. What about the impact to location? Are the locations from which we deliver support services affected, and what is our response? And then last, but certainly not least in this context, impact to people. Are we prepared? Should there be an impact to the individuals responding for delivering service to our customers? And we are actively a part of this. Our organization publishes all of this data for Microsoft at our trust portal. It's at servicetrust.microsoft.com. If you haven't been there, or if you haven't had your individuals out there, there's a wealth of information, including all of our third-party audits to those systems. Our capacity planning, our business continuity management plan is shared with you. Our auditors, as they have gone through third parties and audited that we actually are doing active capacity planning, all those things are intact and ready for you to take advantage of and for that matter, to refer to as you look at your plan, et cetera. And additionally, there are resources for you to actually do planning of your own and to be able to use Microsoft 365 as a part of that and say, hey, these are the things for our continuity plan that we use Microsoft for and that sort of thing. So just want to make sure that you're aware of that resource at servicetrust.microsoft.com. The next piece is specific to COVID-19. I wanted to share the way that we are looking at this situation and sort of a dichotomy that we are looking at the things that we're publishing. The two sides of this are the internal side. What are we doing for employees, contractors, the pieces for organizations who are the subscribers to Microsoft 365 and to Microsoft cloud services in general? And then on the external side, what things have we made available on the external side, which you can use to better work with patients, to scale your operations, those types of things. And that's what we've decided to do, is make that available in this easy to understand format. So things like virtual and remote working, things like safety and communications, exactly how are we handling the self-service needs of our organization, and are we readying employees to be able to handle work on virtual work if they haven't done this before? It's a new thing to the organization. So Sam's going to walk you through a lot of this stuff in more detail. I just want to get the context here. What about company communicator? What about a bot that could reach employees and teams and distributed communications? Or things like crisis management with a power app, so you can enable information so that you know about where people are and who's available, those sorts of things. And then how about a template that could help you to update SharePoint so that you have news and updates and enable those things? We're going to show you demonstrations. Mike's going to go through this one as well. And then on the external side, certainly not least at all, is how are we going to handle the large volume of demand? We know that many of you are scaling in many different ways, but we've got a few tools we want to share with you and Srini's going to demonstrate some of those that will help you to go to the larger volume for your health system, for your organization. We also have payers that are doing this as well around bots. So there's lots and lots of things going on with utilizing the technology. We just that note, we may share with you in the context of a provider or hospital or health system, but it may also be equally useful to handle the volume that's coming in for other organizations within our health and life sciences organization. So just be aware of that. The last thing in my section is around COVID-19 resources. And rather than kind of exhaust this slide, we will share all the links out afterward, but a couple of call outs in here that I wanted to make sure that you're aware of is that if your organization does not have access to Teams that is we're gonna getting ready to demonstrate, that is available to you through an offer we made a week or two ago now, may get the timing wrong, where we've made it available for you free for 6 months. So things like this are available. All these resources are available to you free of charge that are on these slides. So you can definitely take advantage of them in your organization, customize those, et cetera. But last and you know, last thing for me on this context is we realize that there is a tremendous challenge in front of many organizations with responding to what's going on, and we are here to help. And so I want to make that sort of reach out. Mike said in the IM, we'll do our best to get through all the Q&A messages that you bring in, but please feel free to reach out to your Microsoft account teams, et cetera, as well. They are at the ready to handle and understand better anything that you're struggling with. I'm not saying we have a ready-made solution yet for every one of the requests you'll make, but as you can see, we are constantly publishing more. In fact, as we were putting these slides together, more and more blog posts are out. So we'll try our best to keep you updated on the HLS blog with everything that we have in the latest and greatest. Now over to Sam.
Great, thanks, Patrick. I'm gonna start sharing my screen now. Let me know when you can see it.
Not yet. It says the live event will continue in a moment. Oh,
okay.
There it is.
What about now? Perfect. So thanks, Patrick. Let me minimize this here so you can see the whole screen. So definitely wanted to start from the very beginning around the challenge statement at the core of Teams, right? And so for just Microsoft in particular, on March 4th, which is crazy that it was only 12 days ago, but Microsoft asked 50,000 employees in the Seattle area to work from home. And just in one day, by the close of business on March 5th, our chat was up 50% within Teams and our remote meetings were up 37%. And that's just one day, right? That's, you know, since then we all have had our lives impacted, and Microsoft Teams in particular usage is increasing, and workers are having to chat and meet and collaborate only online and not physically in person. So we want to make sure that you're empowered, that you know where to go within Teams to have a productive workday just as if you were in person. And we've definitely made a company-wide commitment to support our customers during this time. So wanted to take you through a couple of those just so you know what I'm going to demo to you here. It's really Teams, virtual and remote working. So just wanted to show you for a day in the life where you can go in and have meetings that you would normally have in person, chat with people directly through Teams, and then also collaborate, both just chatting and talking, but also content sharing with files, videos, etc. So I'm going to take you through a little demo here. Great, so this is our Smarter Health demo. For those of you that haven't seen this before, we actually took a lot of use cases from specifically our healthcare customers and put this together into a live demo so you could really picture yourself using Teams. So as we talked about, want to go through chat on the left-hand side here, Teams and content sharing and collaboration, and then also meetings. So I'm going to start here with meetings. So as I click into this calendar, you can see, for example, that I have a weekly manager meeting set up here. So this is my Teams as a whole. I'm logged in as Dr. Samantha here. And if I click into the weekly manager meeting that I have with Dr. Wyatt and Dr. G, you're able to see what the date is, what time it occurs, the agenda, etc. The best part about this is that every time you have this meeting or you want to refer back to this meeting, you can just click into your calendar and, oh, and we got a notification down here from Dr. G, so we'll have to visit that in a second. But within this manager meeting, you can see all the files that were ever shared on any of these management meetings, all the chat that was ever shared. So as you can see earlier today, we shared a presentation, meeting notes, and files are all shared still on the back end within SharePoint. Meeting notes are here from the previous week's meetings, and you can even have a scheduling assistant for the calendar as well. So this is just one way, and this is a standard meeting that a lot of people are pretty familiar with. So I thought we could start here. But if you close out of this one and you look back at the general calendar, you also have the option, if you need to have a meeting now, you can click Meet Now. Now, I'm not going to do it because I need my audio to present to you guys today, but we could say continue without audio or video, and then you could actually go in and start a meeting right now and bring people in to the meeting. So that's an option as well. One of the things that I think is important to note is you can also create a meeting for a specific Teams channel. So we'll go into Teams and channels right after this, but just so you know where it is, if you go into a new meeting and you want to set it up and you don't feel like going through and adding Dr. Watt and adding Dr. G like I did, you can actually go in and add your specific channel. So this is, you know, within the Children's Hospital team, for example, I could add in the nursing educators, and then it would automatically add all of the people that I needed. So those are three ways that you can do meetings. You can have a standard Teams meeting like you saw with the weekly manager meeting. You can meet now. You can also have a channel meeting. The other one is that if you want to have more of like a one-to-many type of meeting, you're going to create a live event, which for the standard meetings, the cap is at 250 people. For the live event, up to 10,000 people can view this. And this is an example of what we're doing today, right? For this webcast, we simply just set up a live event within here. I'm just gonna say sample live event. You can add in a location if you want. You can add in conference rooms, any details about the agenda. And what's important over here is to add in the presenters or the producers that you want. So say I'm adding in Dr. G and I want to make sure that he can present even though I'm producing. And we have a lot more resources on the live events on our HLS blog that Patrick and Mike were both referencing. So you can definitely dive into more details here. And you have the ability to set it up just for your organization, for the entire public, or just for specific people and groups. And like today, we have Q&A, for example, but you can choose to have that completely turned off. There's a lot of different settings in here. But again, those are the options if you do need to have meetings, depending on the size, depending on who you want to collaborate with and what content you need. Those are your options there. So I'll move on then to chat. So we saw the little notification from Dr. G where I sent him a ping this morning and said, hey, quick question for you. Let's ask him, what did you think about the meeting today? So as you can see, this chat frame is mostly for if I want to chat just one-on-one with someone, or if I want to have a smaller group. So what you can do up here is you can add a smaller group chat. Say I just want to talk to Dr. G and Dr. Wyatt today. I can name it up here manager chat. And I can start chatting with them. What did you both think about the meeting today? Dr. G responds down here. There's a notification from him. He says, hi, Samantha. I can choose to acknowledge it, like it. There's a lot of things you can do down here in the chat to make sure that you get the right expression in, you know, GIFs, attachments. If you attach anything here, then the files will be saved up here, just like the meetings. Let's see what Dr. Watt thought about the meeting today. It was great. Thanks for getting that set up for us. Of course, we'll like it. Meeting was great. We got a little giffy here. So as you can see, these are the options. If you want, what happens a lot of times is this is recent, right? These are the people that you've most recently chatted with. If you have a situation where you need to pin a person that you don't chat with a lot, but you might need to see them at the top for right now, you can actually go over to the side here and click pin. And that'll pin Dr. Watt as a person that comes up within the first couple as soon as I open up my Teams. So just so you have the context here, you can name, you can pin, you can chat, you can do a lot of things within the chat window here, but this is really like part of the core functionality of Teams. So we'll move on here to the Teams side panel. So this is in essence what a team is. A team is, it can be based on your department, for example, or it can be based on a project that you spin up, maybe an event that you spin up, whatever you need to do. But the team always comes with a general tab, and then it also comes with a general channel, excuse me, but then you can also set up a lot of different channels outside of that. And if you look here for my EMR Connect team, there's a little lock button next to the manager channel. So that means that it is a private channel. It's only locked down, for example, in the sample today, to me, Dr. G, and Dr. Watt. You can set it up in here now as of Ignite, so you know, November 2019, where if you add a new channel to a team, you can have it be a standard channel where everyone's invited, or you can lock it down and have it be a private channel, which is definitely something that we've gotten a lot of feedback on, and it's been years in the making. So we're excited about that. But this is the way that you communicate here. So let's go into a specific team example. This is EMR Connect. So we know that for a lot of our healthcare customers, you're spending a lot of time, especially on the clinical side, within the electronic medical records, and you're having to collaborate on information in there without a lot of training and a lot of knowledge on it. So this is an example of like the general manager, the general channel for the EMR Connect. And what you can do in here is you can share any type of information. As you can see, if you go down here, Dr. Strange has shared specific information. Dr. Sally is wondering, does anyone know if I can look up ICD-10 codes in Epic? You can ask questions, clarify here, but then any files, again, that were shared between you are always stored here, which is SharePoint on the back end. And if you have, for example, a lot of questions that are asked over and over again, you might want to create an FAQ tab, and that way that is shared consistently for anyone that might be new to the organization and needs to come up to speed. You can even have training videos or any types of videos shared here, and that again is stream on the back end. So you can really think of Teams as this all-in-one interface for your workday, but there are a ton of Microsoft products that are working behind the scenes, like in this example with the videos with Stream. So you don't need to learn, you don't need to know or think about where do I go to access something. It's all within Teams with the entire Microsoft suite behind it. So that's just general Teams functionality, and I hope that it helps a little to empower you during your workday now that a lot of us are working from home and virtually working. But with that, I will pass it over to Shelly for the next piece.
Actually, I think that's me, Sam.
Oh, perfect.
So that's all right.
So back to Mike.
So I'm going to go ahead and share my desktop and screen two. And let me know when that is showing. There we go. All right. So the beginning, as Sam was showing, was really focused around, and Sam, could you mute, please? Was really focused around the, you know, general capability within Microsoft Teams when we talk about business continuity, which is something that organizations, irrespective of the present situation, should be looking to implement, you know, those kind of areas where people can work. It's that anywhere, anytime, any place work. The next number of sections really are going to start to focus, though, on crisis management, as well as the end sections on some patient outreach. But what I'm going to be talking about is the following. So, you know, we all know that organizations need a clear channel for communications to employees to reduce panic and reduce spread of misinformation during times of crisis. And so what we're going to be looking at here is this solution around a crisis management portal template. It's something that's quickly deployed. It can aggregate communications and employee engagement into a single interface. It can be easily customized, and I'll show you that, to meet any organization's needs. And finally, you can actually push this as a pinned app back into Microsoft Teams if that's where people are working. So rather than talk a lot about this, I do have some resources that I'll be sharing in a bit. I'm going to actually show this. And so let's come on back here. And this is, in this case, our demo environment homepage running on Microsoft SharePoint Online. This is Smarter Health. And so it is a SharePoint site. But what we have done is spun up using Microsoft SharePoint Online the following. So this was spun up using something called the SharePoint Lookbook. So if you come out here, you go to lookbook.microsoft.com, you will see there is a new template that is available for crisis communications. And when you come here, and I have a video I'll be posting up as a follow-up as well, walking you through the process, it's very simple. You're gonna get a crisis management templated site automatically added to your organization for you to customize. And this is what that looks like. So here is that template stood up in our environment. You can see here that it has a couple of items. Number one, and again, this is meant to go in and for you to customize. So it has some placeholders that you can customize in the navigational portion where you can go in and add connections to maybe devices, remote access, building information, personal safety, training. Again, these are placeholders for you to then connect to your information or remove or add as needed. There's a section around besides awareness around services so that you can click in to your various areas. You know, here we're doing geo as an international org, so I have a lot of pharmaceuticals I work with that are multinational, but you might be a regional healthcare organization or some other. Even, you know, we have some folks joining from financial services and others who might want to come in and say it might be by city or however you divide up and then have the appropriate connection. And then finally, we have some areas for news and to connect you to those. On the page itself, though, we have a placeholder that's been filled around we will continue to monitor. So we have some verbiage to immediately catch employees' attention. Again, I'll show you how to customize this in a moment, but you can do that there. We have news from the leadership, and I have here a news posting that we posted. We'll come on back in just a second to what we call a COVID-19 tracker. You know, so much is happening in real time. People want to be able to come out and be able to quickly grab things. So here you can see this is grabbing India. I've just posted this out. This was done by a Microsoft MVP and posted this morning. Which I thought was great, this web part for SharePoint, and users can then come in and select, you know, their own. So I can go in and say, hey, I want to see, oh, I don't know, where do we have US? Da, 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 da. There we go. So I want to see US. I could do by state. So I could say, I want to see just my own state. Oh, I don't know, Pennsylvania, click save. And then I can see information there. And again, I can go in and customize. And, you know, we might want to have none or, you know, different states and take a look at that. But this is a great way for us to go and to provide some information. And here it says this is for educational use only, not meant as a replacement for guidance. So we've put this out there. This is not from Microsoft. I want to be clear. I will have a link to it. It was posted from an MVP, and it was highlighted by the SharePoint team this morning, but I thought it'd be helpful to kind of show some of the things that are coming in real time, and we will continue to provide resources for you to take a look at these things. So we're going to come on back to our homepage. So we have news that's being posted, and again, this is meant for you to customize, put out your own news stories, but we do have placeholders. Then they have an area for a response team where you can have links to individuals, additional resources, again, content. There's content provided to some public facing information. But then down below, we have interactivity. This is pulling from Yammer. And I'll show you how we did that in a moment. But this is a Yammer feed that is around crisis management where people can post their questions. And so people can post things. We can reply right in line. So here we see this is a survey, and I can see, you know, say that things are starting to impact our area. And we can post right from here. So we can do that directly from here. We can post, you know, a new question directly from here, but we can have a running dialogue where employees can engage and you can have folks monitoring that and then calming them, pointing them to appropriate resources, but allowing you to interact with your folks. We also are pulling in here. We have two Twitter feeds, one from the CDC, one from the WHO. But the beauty of all this, because it is a portal template in SharePoint, I have editing rights here, it's just SharePoint. So again, quick and easy to go in and edit. So, you know, here it's a text web part, right? So we can start to type and add our own custom or change out. We can come in and we can do things. Here is that news one, right? And if I click, you can see we can change, it says select news source. So we can do it for different areas. We can change the layout to various layouts. We can do things like showing number of views, et cetera, add filters, audience targeting if we want, so that we can target specific news to specific folks. A whole range of options right there. Down here below, if we click on the We Are Here to Help, again, you can see this is a people part, and we can change how that looks right on the fly if desired. We also have additional web sources or resources. This is nothing more than the quick links part. And you can see we've chosen a list view to show descriptions, show icons. And so users can come in. You can see here we can edit individual ones, but it permits you to have this easy way to quickly add content. Same here for the quick links. One that's showing videos coming out of YouTube, right? So very quickly, we have some public facing videos that are available from authorities worldwide. We could change that out, and I'll show you how to use Microsoft Stream to do that in just a moment. Here's that Yammer one, where if we click, we'll see we're pulling a group. We're pulling this crisis management one that's here, and then we're bubbling that up for our users, so that they can see it right here, and we can change how many conversations they have. We can make it shorter, longer. And then finally, just a couple of examples. But again, all this is just SharePoint. So if we want to add additional content, it is easy. Notice we can add sections and web parts. So we're going to take one example. We have one of our doctors, Dr. G, wants to put out a live webcast under the auspices of their organization at Smarter Health to address the company around the impact of COVID-19 at Smarter Health. To do that, they've gone in and they've created a stream here. So I'm going to go ahead and say, let's look at my content. And I've set up this live webcast, right? You can see the little icon. This is going to be a live webcast. It's scheduled for tomorrow at 9 a.m. for our employees. And so we want to actually share that here. So I'm going to go ahead and click share, and we're just going to grab that link and close it. Come on back to our crisis management site. And to add that, it's as simple as click add a web part. And you'll note, again, it's just SharePoint online. So we have a wealth of things, maps, calls to action, libraries. Maybe, you know, if we're talking about something like ISO 22301 around business continuity planning, you could bubble up a document library right here so that folks could print plans that you have in place, because that's one of the requirements of ISO 22301 you know, for doing business continuity. So you can have that in case they're offline and not able to access stuff, they can have things printed. But we have so many options here. And one of those under the text and media is stream. So I can either put on-demand content. Notice by default, it's going to say all stream and bubble up things. So here I see a virtual visit, how to, beginner's guide to Word, learn basics. But this virtual visit's very timely because that's going to come up in our presentation later. I could do a single video or a channel, a specific channel. Maybe we're have different announcements and things coming out in video format from folks in our org, and we create a COVID-19 channel where approved content's being published. It could dynamically show. In this case, though, we're going to say a single video. We're simply going to paste that one link there. Notice it is dropped a view in. I can close this. I click republish, and that's that simple. So now users coming to our crisis management portal, that one place, when this video goes live and it starts streaming live tomorrow, they'll be able to see it streaming live right here. If I wanted to add additional interactivity for users to comment, etc., maybe I drop in a Yammer channel feed or some other feed, but it gives us this capability to bring all that front and center. And again, this is meant to be customized. Finally, in all things, you know, we can very quickly use something like the App Studio to create an app, and we can wrap in any web page right into Microsoft Teams. So here you can see on the left-hand side, in this case, we have the Smarter Health homepage on here, but we can certainly change that to any page and put that front and center, or change this one out. So we could have our crisis management portal there. Any content that you're creating, and it says which template was used here. Great question. Again, we'll have all the resources following this, and I have a video setting this up step by step. But if you go to lookbook.microsoft.com, you'll see right here in this top row, crisis communications. And when you click it, this was the template that we used. So I saw that question just posted by Anonymous. So thanks for asking that. Before I move, was there any other questions, Sam, that you saw around crisis communications templates? We could take one or two quick.
No, I think you should keep going. Those were good.
Awesome. So that's, I mean, for crisis communications template, that's it. We do have, though, some additional areas. We're going to be showing things around other ways of communicating and interacting with your field next. And for that, who's going to be going next? Is that Shelley, I believe?
It is.
So, Shelley, why don't you go ahead and share your desktop? And there we go. You are live. So take it away.
Yeah, thanks, Mike. And thanks, everybody, for joining today. I really loved how Mike showed how we could use SharePoint to, you know, create that single portal for everybody to come to get all of the great information that your company is sending out. But we still feel like that there are needs to communicate rapidly to a large audience in times of crisis, whether it's inclement weather or in a crisis like we're all dealing with today. We have the need to reach employees and contractors regardless of their location. We have the need right now for so many people to be remote, whether they're on their personal laptop or company provided laptop or even mobile device, we need to be able to reach them regardless of that location or device. We need it to be super simple and fast to be able to engage with employees and get feedback from them on how they're doing in this crisis. Do they need help? Do they need additional information? And just in general, how is the well-being of our employee population going, and what resources are going to be valuable to them in this time? And so I am going to show you a chatbot that has been released for a little bit of time now called the Company Communicator. the company communicator is a way to send targeted communications through Microsoft Teams to proactively communicate across all devices and locations. You can send out quick announcements to disseminate information quickly. You can segregate this to be all company or just specific users in your company. We have seen a lot of organizations rapidly deploying Microsoft Teams during this time of crisis to enable their remote workforce. And so using a tool like Company Communicator can help you send the messages out around what is your remote workforce policy and what training tools are you providing for them as they are needing to adapt quickly to this new reality that we're dealing with. So let me show you a little bit of a demo for that. So here in Microsoft Teams, you can see that I am in the chat area, like Sam and Mike were showing earlier. And right here at the top, we have pinned the company communicator chatbot for my user. And in the chat, you can see that my internal communications or my response team has started sending us communications around restricted travel notice that came out about a week ago and how we're not supposed to have any non-essential travel. Then they sent us another one updating no travel at all and links us to the CDC to get that direct guidance from the CDC and the National Healthcare Advisory. And then finally, we just got a remote work for non-essential employees notice. And in this remote work, it gives us a little bit of information for the next 6 to 8 weeks. We need you to be enabled for Microsoft Teams to be able to host meetings, to chat and collaborate with the people around you. We also link out to a Microsoft Teams training site that will quickly allow your users to get access to any of the on-demand and help that's provided through the Microsoft Learning Pathways. And so you can customize your list here to be able to provide what kind of training and communication that you want for those users. And so how does this work in the back end? So if we go back over to Microsoft Teams, the Company Communicator app is actually loaded into a Microsoft Teams channel. And so we've created this incident response team for all things related to crisis communication and situational response. And so in the general channel of our incidents response team, we've loaded the admin portal of the company communicator. And so only the people that you deem viable to be able to send out these mass communications with your organization will have access to the back end of the app. So not everyone in the org is able to send these large push notifications to your users. And so just quickly, you can click on new message and it brings up this really easy to use form where you can create the title of your notification, add a URL for the image that you want to appear, and then create the body or summary of the message. You can dictate who you are and who is sending this out. And if you want to have a link and a button to hyperlink out to maybe your crisis communication portal, like Mike was showing earlier, or maybe you want to pin this to Microsoft Teams training, or maybe it's just some other form of communication that your senior leadership is trying to communicate to your workforce, you can link that URL here. So once you select the template or create the template, you then get to choose how you want to communicate it. Do you want to communicate it with a specific team, chat to specific people, or chat to everyone in your organization? And then once you save that as a draft, you can just come in here and say send. And so once you hit send, you get one last view to confirm that everything looks great and send that along. Now your end users are going to get a pop-up in the toast of the lower right-hand side of Microsoft Teams. They're going to get a bubble in the chat application, and then the company communicator is going to send them the communication with regards to the notice that you have created. So we really hope that company communicator is something that you guys will take advantage of, because it is this very nice and clean way for internal communications or senior leadership team to send quick updates right in the hands of your workers. And so with that, I am going to pass.
Hey, Shelly. Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. You go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, Shelly, we are getting a lot of great questions about company communicator. And one of them is it available now? And if so, where did they get it?
Yeah, absolutely. Great question. And thanks, Sam and Mike, for pointing that out. Absolutely. So we have all of the resources in company communicator that, and we will share the links to all of those on the slide here in just a few minutes. But I personally deployed this company communicator in this demo environment with distractions. It took me about 45 minutes. And so I know that it's something that your IT organizations could get deployed in your environment in under an hour if that's something that you're looking to do. So absolutely, we'll be sharing those links and resources to get you started with Company Communicator here in the next few slides. Let's see if there are any other questions.
I think that's it for now. Thanks, Shelly.
Awesome. So I am going to pass it over to Michael to talk about the Crisis Communicator app.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. So while that information around the...
Hey, Mike, I think you just need to share your desktop.
Oh, yep. All right, so I'm going to share out. All right, here we go. So everyone should be seeing.
Yep, you're good.
Okay. So the company communicator app that Shelly just walked us through is a great source for this broadcasting of information to all of your workers or a subset, and it really opens up that line of communication. Now, if we wanted to then expand on that and bring a more bi-directional lines of communication where people have the ability to interact with designated individuals during a crisis, we actually built what we called the Crisis Communication app. Now, this is an application that was built using the Power Platform, specifically Power Apps, where this is an interactive app to use from a to facilitate that bi-directional communication. So there's two sides to this application. There's an administrative portion and an end user portion. The end user or the employee facing side of the application gives the ability for an employee to consume information that has been presented. So as the other Mike Gennady was pointing out, you know, the leveraging a portal with notifications through SharePoint is all helpful. But if you wanted to deliver a application-based experience so that people can have that bi-directional nature to it, we have this app as well. You're seeing here that this app was embedded into right? So still leveraging that same Smarter Health content, we see here we can have an actual full-blown mobile application embedded into Teams where the person that's possibly being affected by a specific crisis can go in here and perform a number of actions, right? The first place is, you know, outside of going of getting that information from a portal, they could get it from this app. They can get specific links that are posted here, right? And obviously there's ones that are specific to COVID-19 right now. They could get helpful tips with information provided there for them. Company news and company announcements that are being broadcasted can be consumed through this application as well. World news, right, where they could have specific links, very similar, right? So now where I said in that company communication app or on the portal that was shared also, right, you have your those links or news pieces that are static here. So here is just bringing all that information together in a mobile app type of experience where people can go here and check their app at their leisure. Obviously, a big important part was if something was to happen and someone needed to reach out and perform some type of outreach, there is a section for that as well. There's also, with the shift now for everyone being remote working and the changing of where people are working and how, we actually have the ability to go in and designate where someone is working from, right? If they're out of the office, if they're working from home, and then this information can notify other individuals because, again, this is an app, it can have a workflow process on the back end where once this is submitted, it can notify managers or post to a different board to say, you know, so-and-so is working from home, and we can get a list of all of the whereabouts of where people are. And again, and people are self-expressing this information. Aside from sharing that status, right, if someone is in immediate need during the moment of a crisis, they can use this to reach out and communicate with the proper channels, right? And so in here, we could say, you know, need, you know, assistance with screening of some kind, and they could make a request. What's happening now is this could actually be fed into an actual queue with targeted information towards people that are actively reviewing that queue. As we were talking about earlier in this session with business continuity, but then also the team of individuals that would be manning these types of requests, right? This type of request from this app can go directly to those people. They could see the request directly inside of Teams here, should you want this to be the method of them to work that queue. And from there, they can contact the individual that made that request and follow up with them and so on. And they could do that directly from within Teams, or you could have this pop out and go to email or whatever the method of communication is required. All right. So really just that one-stop shop for all of these components. And again, keeping it all in the area where people are working, right? So this is the employee-based or the user-based side of this application. Then we have the administrator side, where basically we're able to control all of those components that we just saw. Right. And this is just a second app. Right. And this app is also just embedded into Teams here, where from the administrative setting side, we can put in, you know, the admin's email. Right. So where are our requests going to go? You could put in logos in there to personalize it. There's the AD group, right, that is going to be responding to the different responses that are coming in. Right. If you're not going to directly use a help request channel dedicated in Teams. So here you could put in specific RSS feeds. So this one is going back to CDC's RSS feed. So when they update an article there, it's going to automatically populate into the application. And then you can turn on or off the specific features that you'd like. Aside from just the admin settings, obviously, if you wanted to publish components or content into any of the specific areas, you can do that from this app as well, right? So for the company news pieces, you can edit the specific notifications that you want. You can create new posts and have those published into the application for consumption by everyone. All right, so it's a straightforward application. There's, but it definitely solves a lot of need, right? Where now we have an application-based interaction for employees and for administrators and for anyone that is managing incoming requests for a crisis. We have a platform to facilitate all of that. So this app or these series of solutions that are bundled together underneath this app, and I know it was just asked about the company communicator, these are available right now, so you can go and download it. And not only is this available and accessible or gives the ability to be embedded within Teams, but there it could be a standalone experience where people can also use it as part of their mobile devices, right? And here's a blog post. And again, as we said earlier too, all of this information will be shared with you, right, via the slides. So there is a mobile application that is available where people can use it on their mobile devices and still have access to all of the same features, right? And that's both for the administrative and for the end user flavors of the application. And if you, again, we're looking to get this set up, you have the ability to go to GitHub and download this application. This is a Power App where you can download this Power App and deploy it inside of your Office 365 tenant under the Power App section and start to give people access to it, right? And the instructions for doing all of that are here with, and I think Shelley brought this up too, the amount of time it takes to get this up and running is not too much by any means. Another part is because we are giving this information in the form of a Power App where you can download these bits, once you've downloaded this this template, you're able to customize it further. I think Mike Giannotti mentioned, you know, like with the SharePoint site, you're able to customize it and tailor it. So you're able to tailor this application to do any number of things, right? If you wanted to add additional sections from administrative perspective or from the general user perspective, you can do that. If you wanted a more complex workflow for what happens when someone submits a request, like because this is all back-ended with the Power Platform, you can build a more complex workflow where you say, okay, someone submits a request, you know, reach out to that person's manager or someone in HR, have them reach out to the person to make sure everything is okay, notify these people and put the request into the queue. Right, so you can customize what that workflow looks like to meet all of your needs, but then also to be as responsive to your people as possible. Okay, so this is the crisis communicator app. You can customize it further to meet your specific needs, but from where it starts off or where it kind of gets you is gives you the ability to have this one-stop shop in a mobile app, in a mobile application methodology for everyone within your organization, should you want to roll it out that far. So so I'm going to stop there, see if there was any questions about the crisis communicator.
Yeah, thanks, Mike. I think one of the things that we've gotten a few questions on is, can you elaborate a little bit on how the company communicator and the crisis management portal can work together and anything that like overlaps between the two?
Yeah, so I guess one part is if we're looking at the company communicator, so we have these you know broad notifications that go out, right? You know, so this is in the moment. It's like there's this update on this, right? Here's the this piece of communication that you instantly want to get out, right? So the company communicator is great for that. That's one. Also just the technology behind it, right? So the company communicator is not a mobile application. It is baked into Teams and you're able to broadcast this immediate this immediate response at this precise moment, right? It's like, here, look at this information. So that's where the company communicator, company communication apps comes into play. The crisis communication app, right? It becomes more of a resource page where we have, one is a history of, it could be items that were populated like that, right? It could be a whole list of historical communications. There's a section for links specifically, world news, the RSS feeds, right? You're not just having a one place for immediate notifications. You're also building multiple areas of resources, right? And all these are just some examples. Again, you could expand on that. So that's one major difference. The other major difference is the ability for people to have some type of reactive response, right? So if someone is in the midst of a crisis, the employee themselves can go here and they could reach out to the powers that be and start an incident or say that they're affected in XYZ way and submit that and then have a workflow that people that are monitoring this queue are able to then respond to them directly. So it's pulling in all of those incidences that people are self-identifying and putting them into one funneled location so that people can express what's going on with them. And that's centrally monitored, managed, and worked on by targeted individuals. So definitely that bi-directional nature is the second major difference between the crisis communication and the company communicator. The last part is that you do have this mobile app experience as well, right? This is a mobile application that people can download and then use it as a mobile app on their mobile devices. It is not, it doesn't have to be part of Teams. It doesn't have to be part of you know, logging into the corporate environment in order to go and interact with this. They can download the Power Apps app and they could have it on their mobile device as well.
Awesome, thanks, Mike.
So I believe, Sereni, you are up with our external facing examples.
Awesome. Well, let me share my screen. Thank you, Michael. And just to add one more thing, in that integration between the crisis communicator app and the company communicator app, one of the things you can do is use the crisis communicator app as a way of notifying and alerting someone of what they need to do. So if you wanted someone to be able to submit a query that said, hey, we're all safe, you could use the crisis communications app to notify them that go into the company communicator app to say, blast everyone, go into the crisis communicator app and update your quantities for masks, update your information here. Go send us a, are you working from home? This is the place where we go. So there is a interplay because one is connected to data, one is connected to information. The other one is purely more of a, you know, a discoverable, promptable notification that's sent to every user. So they kind of interplay together in that way that one can prompt action on the other and the other can capture information and gather insight that then you can do some analytics on in the background. So they have a great interplay together. So we've spent a lot of time this morning talking about all the tools that we can leverage to enable our employees to be productive, informed, successful, and virtually effective. What I want to now shift is to switch over and start thinking about how do we enable all of our patients, all of the citizens, the rest of the community that we now need to serve. Whether you're, you know, a pharma company that's thinking about how you're going to share information about drugs, or you're a provider that's thinking about how you're going to actually serve this amazing demand that's coming to you of patients that you need to handle. So this is an example. I'm starting here with, there's actually a SharePoint site like Mike was talking about earlier, but I'm going to pretend there's an external facing SharePoint site. And here, you know, you would have all of your patients, customers coming in. You've got a banner up top letting people know that there's information here. You've got news feeds that are coming in, information that they might need to get to or find relevant. And then right next to it, one of the things we want to do is enable a simple way for them to be able to engage, to be able to get more information. And that is via a capability that we have called the healthcare bot. And that health bot allows you to be able to persist either an iframe directly into your webpage that introduces itself to people and allows them to connect with it, or a link to a separate website or a separate web location where you can host that information. And this bot is a way of engaging and triaging patients and citizens to understand their need, understand their concerns, understand the level and severity of what they're dealing with. Because what we found from a lot of organizations in this crisis kind of situation is that there is an immense demand for information and an immense demand for help. And it's hard to call out the things that require immediate attention and the people that are worried that should just be guided to self-guidance and self-support and just informational things that they can just be effective with. So we're going to walk through this example, but instead of doing it in this experience, I'm going to do it in a mobile experience because oftentimes we're working in mobile environments. And so what I wanted to do is just do this in a mobile scenario. So let me pull up my mobile device here alongside my website. So hopefully you're able to see both things. next to each other, side by side. Oops.
Yep, we can see it.
Window sized correctly, so you can see both. And then I'll extend this a little bit bigger. So here's the web view of this site. And then I'm going to go here, and you can see here's the mobile view of the same site. And so what I'm going to do in this situation is I'm a customer. I'm coming in. I'm going to say, oh, you know what? There's some more information here for support. I'm going to connect with this bot. So I'm going to go ahead into this bot experience. And so as I click into that bot experience, it's going to open up this bot. And let me zoom in here. If you can see on the right-hand side, it's asking me questions. It's saying, have you recently traveled any of the following countries? And I'm going to say no to that. Then it says, have you been in contact with someone who's traveled? And I'm going to say no to that. And it's going to ask me, have you been in contact who has known to have contracted the COVID-19? And I'm going to say no to that. Have you been informed by any public health officials? No. But I do have a fever and a cough, right? So this is actually a triage flow that was taken from the CDC, and it was worked with some doctors at a Pacific Northwest hospital who kind of embedded this flow into it. And I'll show you just in a little bit how you can customize and manipulate and modify that flow. So as I look at this, I'm going to say, are you experiencing shortness of breath? I'm going to say yes. And my answer of yes to that question is going to automatically trigger, I don't know if you can see this at the bottom of the screen, but it immediately says, we're going to connect you to an agent, please wait. And so what I'm going to do is switch over here, because what we've done is we've triaged this and we've said, uh-oh, this kind of severity, we actually want to live have you chat with an agent. So what I'm going to do is switch over here to my Teams experience, and I'm a nurse now sitting over in Teams, and I'm going to go to my chat, and along with all my chat conversations is this chat thread that I have with Contoso Health System Teams bot. And so as I look at that, I can see a new user has joined and is waiting in the queue. And so I'm logged in, I can see, and I can list all the users, and they're being queued by the health bot. So I can see all of these conversations being queued. And then I have a number of options I can leverage within the Teams console to be able to connect. I can just click connect, and it'll route me to the latest person that's in the queue. I can also click connect and use a specific user ID. So I'm connecting to that particular conversation. And if I want to go ahead and look in on this particular conversation that I just kicked off here, this 13th conversation, I can go ahead and look at that conversation history, and I can see, okay, I can get some context on what's happened here, what the discussion has been, how did they answer these questions? Okay, great. So I've got context. Now I'm going to go ahead and say connect. Oh, sorry, I got to log into my mobile here real quick. So I'm going to go ahead and do connect 720E. So it's going to go ahead and connect me or not. Let me flip back over. Let me just switch something here. I want to make sure I'm connecting with the right person. Okay. Let me switch over to the right user here. Because I had so many users on this demo before. So let me just switch to my private browsing mode. Not this one. Not that one. I can't find the connection that I made with one of these users, and I'm going to go ahead and try to do this connect again. But when I have that ability to go ahead and connect, I can connect with a conversation thread, And when I'm connected with a conversation thread, I can have a chat directly between this agent in Teams and this agent over, or this patient who's waiting over here in the waiting room. It's a little bit messed up here because I've got so many different conversation threads that I've started and I'm not able to connect to the right one. But once I'm connected, if I just connect to a conversation thread, it'll find the latest one in queue. Let me go back to the list again. I connect to a user and I'm able to connect to that conversation, then I'm actually able to have a chat conversation. And once I connect, I'm also able to escalate that by, if I'm connected, let me just see if I can just straight connect to a user. All right, let me initiate another chat here so I can have a connection. Okay, let me initiate a new conversation and then let me connect so we can actually have a conversation thread that we want to connect with. So I'm going to go ahead and say, yes, I want to speak to a nurse practitioner. It's going to ask me some more questions. Okay, connecting me to an agent. Connect here. Okay, as I connect there, you can see agent Dr. Srini has connected over here. So I'm going to say, hello, this is Dr. Srini. How are you today? And you can see over here on this side, that chat conversation that patient has started. So the patient then is going to go ahead and reply, not well. Need a consult, not a Cubs fan. And then as I send that message, then it comes over here. So I know they want a consult and I'm going to go ahead and ask them. Ask them if they're willing to do a video consult and then they're going to come over here and say, yes. Oops, typing on the wrong device. Let's say yes, absolutely. And then as they say yes, then I'm going to come over here and I'm going to just simply type meeting. And what this is going to do is coin off the API to be able to go in the background and create a Teams meeting. And it'll immediately create a Teams meeting and post one for me to be able to access. And at the same time, it'll also post one for that patient to be able to access. Now, the patient can join this meeting without needing a login, without needing a license. They can just join anonymously. So I'm going to go ahead and take that link and I'm going to open it in a new tab as a private browsing tab. So I'll open up that tab and I'll show you. It's going to ask me to go ahead and open the meeting because it's on mobile, on the Teams mobile app. And so it'll open up Teams and it'll open up that meeting and allow me to have a video consult. And if I'm connected from here, I can actually have that exact same experience. I can't do that now because I'm already in a meeting here presenting. So I can't quite click this and join it. But you can kind of see that experience. And then we can have a direct connection from that chat, from that web interface, directly to a care team that's sitting over here on the Teams side. And this can support, you know, it doesn't support like thousands of call center agents, but if you had a group of call center or nurses who are doing this on the team side, it could support a good group of those people leveraging this capability to be able to create this kind of virtual connection and this virtual integration to, you know, response. So that's kind of that workflow from both that patient engaged website where they were able to see what options are available, what information is available, and then they were able to transition that directly to a chat with the actual care agent on the team side, and also to be able to communicate and connect that into a video consult if they wanted. Now what I'm going to do is go back to full screen over here, move out of the mobile, and I'm going to talk about another part of this equation. So let's say you've had this initial consult, you've told them to be self-quarantined, you've told them to go ahead and be home. Now you want to go ahead and transition and say, you know what, we really ought to do a week after follow-up assessment with the same patient. So I've got a number of clinicians here that are part of my care team. And within this bookings app, which is our virtual consults bookings app, I can now go in and start to slate in consults with different patients that I can go ahead and schedule out with the available hours that my clinicians are able to do those virtual consults. As you can see, the clinician schedules their busy and free data directly flows in, so I can see when they're already occupied, so I don't over schedule on top of their existing schedule. So when I use this virtual consults bookings app, I have the ability to set up multiple different departments, if you will. So this is the COVID-19 response department. Now, I might want to create a new business department. And let's say for the sake of just showing you what this looks like, I'll just create a new business department called, and we want to specifically have an elderly follow-up home care. So we might have some virtual appointments that we want to do with elderly follow-up care with home care. And so we might pick what kind of business this is. We'll pick healthcare because we want to abide by some of the compliance requirements, which you'll see when we actually create an appointment. You can add an email alias. So the beauty of this is this appointments capability, it doesn't actually expose your doctor's email alias. You set up an alias that is part of your business. So this might be elderly home care contoso@contosohealthsystem.onmicrosoft.com. So now I'm setting up a business or a department email that is not tied to any one individual nurse or doctor. And I can add a phone number for the business, et cetera. So I can set up a business this way. I'm not going to actually set this up. I just wanted to show you that process of setting up a different business. But when you set up a business, some of the components of that business are as follows. So you have the business type, the email, and the phone number. You have appointment types, because often we find that there are typical appointment types that you're trying to schedule for and plan for. They could be, you know, in this case, a screening, an elderly virtual visit, a quarantine follow-up. We've defined those, and inside of each one of those, we have defined what information or links are being provided, what kind of email reminders are being sent. Let me go back to one that I've already customized. So here I have information from the CDC that I've pasted as part of a standard part of that kind of meeting. I've also added a number of reminders, a day reminder and a 15-minute prior reminder for the attendee. You can add as many reminders as you want as part of this template. And I can set up as many of these different appointment types as I want. And I get the opportunity to add and bring together the respective doctors, nurses that are part of this group, so I can have them all within this organization and see all of their current schedules and start to plan against their capacity to be able to schedule virtual visits. So that's the setting up of the department. And once I've set up the department now, I can go ahead as an administrator, start setting up appointments. So I'm going to go ahead. I see here that Dr. Sohail is available. And also I see Nurse Mueller is available. What I really need for this appointment is both a doctor and a nurse to be on. And I see they're both available here at 12:30 for an hour appointment. So I'm going to go ahead and pick that hour appointment. I'm going to pick the kind of appointment this is. So I'm going to pick a screening appointment. I'm going to do patient's first name is Jim Smith. And I'm going to use my Gmail account so you can kind of see what the experience is like. I'm going to add a phone number. So I've started this with Dr. Sohail, but I'm also going to add Nurse Mueller to this, so I can have her in this consult as well. I can also add additional notes. I can add the MRN number of the patient. I can add initial diagnosis has asthma. and other respiratory. Be able to spell well. Okay, and then I can see all of those reminders that I've previously set have already been brought in based on the template that I've chosen of screening. So now I'm going to go ahead, create this appointment and go ahead and hit send. And what, and I also have to attest here, because again, this is a healthcare organization, I have to attest that the attendees have consented for email communication, enabling my HIPAA compliance. So I'll go ahead and send this invite out. What this will now do is go ahead and create this appointment. It's a little bit awkward because I'm creating an appointment in the past. I do that specifically because those alerts will go out in email. And as I log into my Gmail account, you can see those invites that have come through. So as you can see here, the appointment was created for Jim Smith. It's, and I might not want to add their last name. I might want to just add Jim S so that it's not visible in this view. But I now have that same appointment for Dr. Sohail and Dr. Mueller, or Nurse Mueller set. Let me go into my inbox and I can see that these two new appointments just showed up, right? One is the actual appointment. The other one is the reminder. And again, we're already within 15 minutes of the appointment, so it's already come through. So now when I click into it as the user, I can look down here and I can see, this is me. These are who I'm meeting with. This is what it's for. And I can also see all of that information, that additional information that I already pasted in there as part of this templated appointment that I wanted to make available. So now this patient can just click on this link, just like we saw before, and be able to join a meeting. I'm gonna go ahead and open, because I did the mobile device before, and I'm gonna open this in an in-private window so you can see that WebRTC join experience on desktop. So on desktop, if someone is trying to join this meeting, all I have to do is just allow this to use my camera and my my audio recording capabilities. And you can see right there, I'm already joined into this meeting. I'm into this curated kind of lobby experience. I can say I'm Jim. I can set my audio and video options. I can go ahead and hit join now. This might cause a little interference, so I might shut out of this, but it'll let me know that I've been let into the lobby. I'm waiting for the doctor and nurse to join so that we can actually start that meeting. So very simple join experience. There's nothing to download, nothing to install, just a direct WebRTC link directly into both Edge and in Chrome. We have that direct WebRTC interface to be able to join the meeting. So I'm gonna close out of this, close out that experience so I can go back over here. The other thing that we might wanna do is also make it available, now that I have all these appointments, I don't wanna have to schedule every appointment. What if I could just take all of this schedule and make it visible as part of my clinic, as part of my urgent care facility? What if I could just post all of these availabilities so that people can just go in and make their own appointments? This is also really relevant as they're standing up all of these centers around the country to be able to do drive-through screenings. There's going to need to be a scheduling process, an availability process to be able to self-select appointments. And so if you have availability here in this bookings app, we enable this really neat thing to be able to open this in bookings. And when you open it in bookings, you have the ability to create this as a bookings page. And that bookings page has a link, and you can embed this link into your actual patient portal. So let me go back to the patient portal where we started this whole exercise. And so we kind of went through this. We saw this link. We saw this bot in action. But then what we can also do is, if you need a visit, we can instruct people to just schedule their own visit from available options from this here below. So they can come into this experience and they can
Sereni? It looks like Sereni has lost connectivity. just if he picks back up, we'll continue with Sereni. But we had some comments about, his kids at home. Yes, this is real. We're all working remotely. But just to kind of highlight what Srini was talking about, so there is the capability to be able to take that view and be able to provide it. So now we can have a free busy time. So what can happen is, instead of having, for example, the folks send in a request or contact and then have to go up and set up the appointment and shoot it out, this allows really that patient self-service capability to be able to be provided there. And so I'm going to go ahead, and he's now dropped completely. So I'm going to share out in the interim my own desktop. There we go. And that should be showing just about now. All right, so what he was showing again, it was just that patient self-service to be able to see free busy time, or when time is available for appointments, to grab that and them actually initiate that virtual consult through the app. So a lot that was there. So we've had a lot of questions. Somebody said they're having some connection problems. I hope that it looks like we still have most people. I believe that was, just a couple of video or audio froze, but IM works. Can you hear me now? Can somebody indicate?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. So I believe what you saw, it wasn't around the broadcast itself. Serini's connection back in his own home appears to have frozen, or he had some issue with his internet connectivity. But we want to thank everybody. We had a lot of questions going on. We are going to be posting, if there are questions now for the rest of us, feel free to post those. We can do Q&A for a bit. I did have quite a few questions asking repeatedly, will this be recorded? Will it be available? And also, where do you get the resources or downloads? So a couple of things. Number one, yes, this is being recorded. Yes, and thank you. Yes, we can hear you. Thank you for letting me know. So yes, this is being recorded. This will be available at our blog site, as I indicated, and I'm going to bring that up. So here you can see aka.ms/HLS blog. That is on, thank you, Tom, for letting us know. Yeah, I think it was really on Serini's end. Tom was letting us know that he hasn't experienced any interruptions. So over here at the blog, you'll notice we already have a couple of things that are supportive of what we did today, right? Where we have here this quick start setting up your COVID-19 health bot. So that's a step-by-step. I showed, integrating in those live events into the crisis management portal. Here's a whole tips around that, with information, and we're going to continue for everybody that presented. We have some additional follow-up ones. For example, I have a step-by-step video how to set up the crisis management portal, and we will have more. Please feel free to take a look at the blog this afternoon. The recording of this, all the resources mentioned will be highlighted and posted here, and as well as any follow-up posts, we'll have those as well. So, that's all going to be available. If there are any questions, though, for our remaining few minutes, feel free to post those. And in the meantime, I did have, and this was my one slide kind of just showing, right, where we're going to have all that. This really, again, to reiterate, is the place to find us. You can post questions. We get frequently questions get posted to various blog posts the bloggers from our end will go ahead and respond directly to, and you can do so as well. We get other, requests for new content, and we do respond to those. The other place where you can find any and all of us is on LinkedIn. So we're all very active on LinkedIn. Again, if you see any of the posts coming up, and I'll have in the archive post for today all the speakers listed with links to their LinkedIn contact information. You can reach out to us there as well. We love to engage with customers. We love to work with you. So I haven't seen anything new come out. So I just want to, I guess we'll go ahead and close. We'll give you back time. I know this was a long session, but we had a lot of content to cover. I want to thank everybody for joining us today. And on behalf of all of the technical and sales and support staff at Microsoft's Healthcare and Life Sciences Group, we want to thank you, our partners and customers, and we consider our customers partners. We want to partner with you. Please, if you have questions about stuff you saw today, ask us, but also contact your Microsoft team, your account team. We've had quite a few organizations already, even over the weekend, who have been stood up. We've had organizations who had no teams presence be brought up overnight and over the weekend, stood up and start to have some of the things you saw today working within their orgs so they can respond to the, you know, present situation with COVID-19. We want to help. We want to partner with customers. You know, everything that you saw today was stuff that's freely available. The one possible exception, and there is, we'll have a resource link to this, would be the Azure, the bot, right? So the health bot or the COVID-19 bot. But even then, we have a, there is a link that we'll provide for, you know, being able to get access to that for, I forget how many months we're providing access to that as well, because we want to help, right? I mean, bottom line is, you know, we want to help our customers. We want to help all of you in this time. We understand how stressful it can be for you, your employees, your patients, if you're in healthcare, but we want to help, and that's the bottom line. So with that, we're going to go ahead and close up today's broadcast. Thank you for tuning in. Take care. Let us know how we can help and look for the follow-up. I'll have that posted within the next hour or two. Have a great day and a great rest of the week. Goodbye for now.